you. Glad you're on the winning side. Man, I've already read the end of the book. I know what's going to happen. Amen. Let's take our hymn books and turn to 245. Let's stand and sing "The Old Account Was Settled Long Ago." 245.
By any way, but I'm glad that he did. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Brother Jackie Kendrick, if you don't mind, would you please open us up in prayer? Thank you. You can be seated. Boy, has it not good to be in God's house tonight?
Yes.
Man, I am thankful for what I have already felt inside of my soul.
Right.
Looking forward to what God's going to do continuing out. Please be much in prayer for Brother Neal, that Lord would just touch him and help him and give him exactly what we need. Choir got some special singing lined up. Pray about that. Pray the Lord just touch and help and meet all the needs with everything that's going on here tonight. Everybody be obedient to the Spirit of God. Thank you for coming out. Thank you, choir, for doing such a wonderful job. You carry that out tonight. We'll give God the glory. Amen. He is the one that deserves all the glory. Again, thank you for being here. I love you. I appreciate you. You be much in prayer for them while they sing.
Thank you. span of history, and even now I plainly see, when facing the uncertain days, there's peace in His sustaining grace. No longer bound by sin and shame, since I trusted in His name, my life is now a picture of His mercy flowing from above. Try as I might, I'll never see why the hands that made the world were pierced for me.
I love that sustaining grace. You know what sustain? It never ends. Yeah, I love that. So I'm telling you, boy, I love that song. Ty's done a wonderful job on that, buddy. I appreciate that. Let's take our hymn books, 143. Blessed Assurance, my favorite song in the book. 143.
Blessed Assurance.
All right, on that last verse, here we go. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness.
song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Now this offering we're taking up, I forgot to mention it last night, this is for Brother Neal. This is not the regular church offering. So this is the last night. How many's enjoyed it all week long? How many's got a little stress off their shoulder all week long? How many's ready for this next one tonight? Oh, me too. Some of you not raising your hand. That's okay. But it's been good, I'll tell you what. But every dime that's taken up is going to Brother Neal. Okay, if you need to write a check, make it to Liberty Baptist Church, because we're just going to add it all up and put one big old check there for him. Okay? Sir? I still didn't hear what he said.
He said you got a check hidden bar.
I got a check. Yeah, I got a check somewhere up here. All right, well, let's bow our heads and we'll pray. Father, we thank you for this day today. God, thank you for meeting with us this week. What a special week it's been. Thank you for the choir members that's been so faithful. Thank you for the people that's come out, God. And God, especially for Brother Neal, I pray, God, that you'll just bless him for all the efforts he's done here in helping our church out. Thank you, God, for giving him the messages and nudging his heart in the direction that we needed. God, I know it's helped me. It's helped me tremendously, God. And, Father, I pray that you'll take this money. I pray, God, that you'll just multiply it. I pray it to be used for your honor and your glory. And, Father, I pray after this service tonight that you'll give Brother Neal safe travels back home. We love him and appreciate him. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done here at Liberty Baptist Church. We love you. And thank you for everything. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Musicians, boy, they've been wonderful this week. We couldn't have done it without them. I taught them everything they knew on that stuff, but they're doing a great job on that stuff, ladies. I appreciate that. And our sound crew back there, we appreciate that. Well, we've had a request tonight for the Little Ladies Trio to come and sing. Would y'all like to hear the Little Ladies Trio tonight? All right. Now, preacher's already told me. Now, look at that. That's okay. Go ahead and clap. Preacher instructed me that they've got to move over here tonight. So let me come, Little Ladies Trio, y'all come on up. All right, here, you take that one right there. You got the blue one, that's your favorite color.
All right, y'all need a copy of that. All right, now get up, we got to slide on over here. Slide on over here a little bit. There you go, all right. All right, there, go ahead.
Sometimes I feel so small, I wonder what God wants from me. What will I be? I listen for his calls and try to wait so patiently, though I may not see. When I cannot find my way, I just remember the promise he made. I know the plans I have for you. I know exactly what to do. I will work a wonderful sometimes seems so strange to me. It's a mystery. I try to understand and follow everywhere he leads, for my heart believes. When I cannot see the end, I just hear him saying again and again, I know the plans I have for you, I know exactly what to do, I will work a wonder for your good. I will listen when you pray,
give you peace for each new day.
Trust in me your whole life through, I know the plans I have for you. Search me with all your heart, seek me and you will find a future filled with hope, the purpose for your life. I know the plans I have for you, I know exactly what to do, I will work a wonder for your good. I will listen when you pray,
give you peace for each new day.
Trust in me your whole life through, I know the plans I have for you. Trust in me your whole life through, I know the plans I have for you.
I love y'all so much for doing that. I don't know what to say after that. Let me have the trio to come up here. We've been, had a request for Brooke and Kaylee and Titus to come and sing. Bragging on Jesus. Had a request for that.
I just need to brag on Jesus before we get started. I couldn't help but, with my baby up there singing, that Brother Neal, 8 years ago when you came, I was praying for a baby. And we have been praying and praying and praying for about a year. And in revival, when you were here, that was when I gave it to Jesus. That's when I just left it, sent it over to him. From that moment on, there's just a peace and a weight off of you. If you just give it to him, he wants you to give it to him.
Amen.
And I want to thank the Lord for answering prayer.
Yeah.
And if you haven't given it to him, I hope that you would ask him in your heart and he would turn over whatever you're holding on to him. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
It occurs to me, we all seem to have a testimony of a time when Jesus helped us up and showed to us his mercy. Now we've gathered here to silence the noise of what other voices are saying. Let's drown them out by talking about our wonderful The joy no one can take away, to think of all he gave me. I could sing all day and rejoice all night, and it still wouldn't be quite enough. The praise is still, we'll give it to you, the Lord God Almighty. You're the God Almighty. So
let's take turns bragging on Jesus. I'll be the first to tell what he's done. He brought me back from the edge of destruction and gave me a life that I don't deserve. Could I take a moment to talk of his grace, how his mercy found me when I ran away? I know he desires the praise of his people, so let's take turns bragging on Jesus. Has he been good to anybody else?
If he has, just raise your hand.
Has he been good to anybody else?
If he has, just raise your hand. So
let's take turns bragging on Jesus. I'll be the first to tell what he's done. He brought me back from the edge of destruction and gave me a life that I don't deserve. Could I take a moment to talk of his grace, how his mercy found me when I ran away? I know he desires the praise of his people, so let's take turns bragging on Jesus.
Bragging on Jesus.
We have so much to brag on the Lord about, amen. We could start now, try to brag on the Lord, and you know what? We would run out of time. We would run out of thought. We'd run out of things because God is so good to us. What a thrill it is, Brother Neal, to have you here again. Of course, I've done got with him and set the date for next year, which is the same week. This week works for the same week every time, and I know it wobbles around. Ladies Fellowship will go a week earlier and do a lot of things like that, but it's always the same week that God keeps putting back on my heart to do this. And I've learned, there's one thing I've learned to do what God says. So it's a long ways away. I don't care how far it is away. God always plans and God always puts it together. You pray for the man of God. Pray if you would for Brother Neal that God just touch him and help him and give him exactly what we need here tonight. Thank you, preacher. Thank you for being obedient.
Good evening. Praise God, you got better at that. Amen. Amen. I've taught you one thing if I hadn't taught you anything else. Amen. But it is good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Thank God for the privilege. Appreciate all the good singing, all week, and I'm wondering where the little ladies trio, wonder where they've been all these years.
Yeah, there you go.
You know, I mean, they should have been singing 8 years ago. But I do appreciate that and look forward to hearing them again next year. How's that? All right. But it has been my honor. I want to say to each one of you, thank you so much for allowing me to come. It's always a highlight of my year. I look forward to getting to come down here. I bragged on you and carried you with me in my prayers, and thank God for you. The friendships that we have been able to make each year seems like I meet someone new that I have not known before or not known a face and not known. And then we've had some of those that's graduated from our ranks since that time, and certainly do miss them and the privilege and opportunity to be with them. But one day after a while,
yeah.
Amen, there'll be a gathering on the other side. None of us will ever leave. And I can think about old Brother Ted. He's already scoped out all the eating joints in heaven, going to tell us all about them and where to go and to be a part of them. And I'm sure Brother Donald English is trying to get them to sing one of the songs that he wrote, amen,
yeah.
and asking the Lord about that. But God is good, and I praise his name.
Yeah.
Christian people are some of the greatest people that I've met on this earth. And I thank God for genuine Christian people that are saved by the grace of God and in love with God and eager about what the Lord wants to do for them. And just thank God for this privilege and this opportunity. Been a little different this week. I don't normally come in and preach all week on a specific subject for the entire week, but that is where the Lord has kept my heart each night. Sort of got myself in the way a little bit today and thought, you know, well, maybe I've just bored them to death on this stress stuff and need to go somewhere else. But I really feel like that I need to stay where I'm at and preach this message tonight. And Lord willing, I'll be preaching on stress Sunday. If God don't change me, I'm probably going to preach another one to our church on stress that I've been studying this week. But do thank you so much for your kindness, your hospitality, the fine room that you provide for us, the meals that you provided for us. I do thank you for that, your fellowship and the blessing that it is. And just thank the Lord. Had it not been for salvation, our paths would have never crossed.
Amen. You're right.
Our paths would have never crossed. They were singing one song there. Have you ever thought about how your life would have been if you'd never got saved? I'm confident I would have never come to Liberty Baptist Church. Don't know if I'd ever been to Toccoa, Georgia, and I'm sure I wouldn't have went to Tugaloo. Hello? You just don't know, and I know you're going to tell me how to say it after service, and next year I'll call it Tugaloo again just to aggravate you. Amen? But God's good, and I praise his name for his goodness, his grace, and his mercy, and all that he does for us each and every day. All the people in the world that Brother Doug Westmoreland could have spent his 62nd birthday with, and he chose to spend it with me. Sorry, Donna. But he chose to spend it with me. I asked her when I come in, I said, have y'all had any birthday cake yet? She said, I ain't been able to pin him down long enough to celebrate with him. We went and exercised, visited some stroke victims today. And it's the grace of God that we're all able to be here tonight. And do what? Yeah, old preacher Stacy, I think he needs a set of golf clubs. I really feel the will of God working that way. But we came back to Bell's, and I don't know about every restaurant in Alexander County. If they find out it's somebody's birthday, they'll come out and do one. Oh, I wanted to do that so bad, so bad, so bad. But he's bigger than me, so I didn't, all right? But if y'all get a chance, certainly wish him a happy birthday. Appreciate the job he does with the choir. Y'all always do a fantastic job, and I appreciate that. Appreciate you letting the Lord use you. And don't get weary. Don't get weary in well-doing. Amen. I don't know how much longer this thing's going to last, but let's finish her out, and let's finish her out well. And let's not give in, let's not give up, let's not give over. Let's just be faithful to do that the Lord would have us do. If you have a copy of God's Word, if I would tell you tonight to turn to the oldest book of the Bible, where would you turn? Amen. You're exactly right, sister, the book of Job. So I want you to turn to the book of Job. It is the 18th book of the Bible, or the 18th book of the Bible and the 18th book of the Old Testament, both. Job is the first of what is called the poetical books. You'll find the Old Testament is divided up into 17 historical books. Then you have 5 poetical books. And then you have 17 prophetical books making up the Old Testament. And the book of Job is thought to be the oldest book of the Bible. Now, it's not first chronologically, but it is thought to be the first one. And most scholars attribute it to Moses as being the writer of the book of Job. But this is where the Lord has me, and I'm just praying the Lord will help me be able to preach this tonight. Last year, let me just share a few things here, and I'll preach, and I'll go to Taylor's, okay? Last year, of all the years I've been coming, I felt like last year we had as good a revival as we had ever had. I mean, I left here, and I think I have had wonderful liberty to preach this week. We've not swung from the chandeliers, but thank God's helped us. I really believe that God has helped us this week. But as I would... I pray a lot of times whenever I get ready to preach, Lord, help me to preach more than a message on paper, more than an outline that was written down. I want to have a burden on my heart. And there are some messages you can feel. You know, sometimes some of you that sing, there are songs that at the particular time, you can just feel it. But sometimes you sing and you don't really feel it. And then all of a sudden you see somebody back yonder that even though you're not feeling it, man, their wheels are starting to wobble because of what's going on. Sometimes you got to faith it when you can't feel it. Because you're not always going to feel it. There are a lot of Sunday mornings I don't feel like going to church. But I faith it, and I go on to church. There's a lot of revivals I've been in that I did not feel like going to preach. Now, I'm going to be honest. I love y'all. I love y'all. I love y'all. And I love to preach to you. But, boy, last night, if my wife would have said, come home, I'd have left you. I'd have left you in a hurry. Amen. My heart is already in Alexander County tonight. That's where my heart's at. My wife and my daughters and, oh, my grandbabies. Tomorrow's Nobo Friday. Hallelujah. But you do what you do based on faith.
Amen.
Based on faith. You do what's right based on faith even when you don't feel it. Sometimes you don't feel like coming to revival, but you come anyway by faith. Because you know it's the right thing to do. And when you're coming by faith, God is doing things in your life that you're not even aware of. All right? Maybe that'll help you, and maybe that'll help me too as I try to preach. Now, don't get all blowed out and say, Lord, the preacher was going to leave. Amen. If she calls and said, I need you, come home, I'm going home. I'm going home right then. Amen. You better not bring my cell phone to me right now and her be on it. Hello. Amen. But I'm thankful that I got a love for my family, got a love for my church, got a love for the things God allows me to do, and I'm humbled to be here. And I don't know, I thought surely after this year, the way I preached, that he'd probably get somebody else next year, but I'm humbled, and I will begin praying tonight on my way home. The Lord will help us next year. If he tarries, he's coming. And if the Lord comes back, I'm not going to be here. I hope you're not, but I'm not going to be here if the Lord comes back. Amen. Job chapter number 1, won't you look at verse number 12. First 11 verses gives us a little outline who Job is, what a great man he is, how God has blessed him physically, God has blessed him financially, God has blessed him spiritually. He has 10 wonderful children that God has blessed him with. Then we're told about a conference that is held between the Lord and the sons of God as they come to present themselves. Then that conversation gets narrowed down between Almighty God and Satan himself. And the Lord says, "Have you considered my servant Job, a perfect man, upright, one that fears God and escheweth evil?" And then you'll find in verse number 12, the Lord gives the devil permission to trouble Job, to try Job, and to give him problems in his life. Look at what verse number 12 said. "The Lord said unto Satan, Behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thine hand. So Satan went from the presence of the Lord. And there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And there came a messenger unto Job and said, The oxen were plowing, the asses feeding beside them, and the Sabians fell upon them and took them away. Yea, they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, The fire of God is fallen from heaven and has burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I am escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, The Chaldeans made out 3 bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away, yea, and slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, Thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. Behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the 4 corners of the house, and it fell upon the young men. They are dead, and I am escaped alone to tell thee. Then Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshiped. Worshiped. And said, Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Titus, how about you praying for me, if you would, please, sir. Amen. Thank you so much for the prayer tonight. I want to preach message number 4 in the series of God Sent Stress. And I want to preach tonight by the help of the Lord on the stress of losing everything. The stress of losing everything. Each night I've told you this life is a stressful thing. We have stress in every area of our life, every facet of life. There's stress where you work. There's stress in your marriage. There's stress in your finances. We find stress in the house of faith. We find stress in our friendships and our health. On and on it goes. Sometimes people bring stress into our life. Sometimes we bring stress to our own life. But then there are those times, as we've been studying this week, when God Almighty allows stress to come into our life, not because he is wanting to destroy us, but rather because God is wanting to develop us into that would bring glory and honor and praise unto his name. Yes, sometimes stress comes to correct us, But in our text, as it's been several nights this week, with the exception of Tuesday night, that stress has been for the purpose of constructing us in the work, in the service of the Lord. Now, on Monday night, we dealt with the if-not attitude as we looked at the three Hebrew boys and how that they purposed in their hearts to serve God no matter. They knew God could deliver them, but they did not know if God would deliver them, if it was His will to deliver them. But they purposed in their heart, irregardless, God, if You do what we're praying about, You do what we ask, or God, if You don't, for some reason, we're still going to serve You. Then on Tuesday night, we dealt with the stress of living on the edge out of John chapter number 5 as we looked at the crippled man that had been a burden for everyone for the last 38 years of his life. He had lived in frustration, in depression, and in despair. But then Jesus came by and gave him an opportunity to lay all that stuff aside. Thankfully he did, and he went from being a burden on everybody else to carrying his own burden as well as being one that could help and carry the burden of others. Last night we dealt with the stress of constant change as we dealt with Daniel as he was facing a den of lions. How that they did everything they could in the lifetime of Daniel to try to get Daniel to change. But Daniel was a man that purposed in his heart he was not going to change, and he stayed faithful to the Lord in his prayer life each and every day. All of these were successful in dealing with their stress, even though they had to go through some difficult circumstances in life. Listen, there's going to be hard times. There's going to be troublesome times. But if we'll let God help us, God can help us with the stress that we deal with in our life each and every day. Now, as I said, the book of Job, our text tonight, is considered the oldest book in the Bible, and it is commonly thought to be written by Moses. And as you study the book of Job, you'll find the book of Job only deals with 1 year in the life of Job, and it deals with the hardships that he encountered within that year of his life. A lot of times we read through our Bible real quick and we read about David and we think, huh, you reckon David was really a real guy? You read about Abraham, you read about Isaac, you read about all these guys, and sometimes we've got this idea that they're bigger than life or something. Well, I'll tell you, Job was a real person. And Job had real problems in his life. And Job is a man that because he was a real person that had real problems in his life, he can help you and I as we're trying to live in this real world that we're living in each and every day. You'll find Job is mentioned also in the book of Ezekiel chapter number 14 as well as James chapter number 5. So he was not just some man that a story was made up about. Job was a real man that lived in the real world. You'll find that in just one day, Job went from being the richest man that there was in the world at that time to being totally bankrupt in one day. If you want to get real technical about it, you take your Bible and you read the text that I read from verse number 12 down to verse number 22, and you read it real slow without trying to read speed readingly, and it will take you somewhere around 37 seconds. In 37 seconds of Job's life, Job lost everything that he had in this life. In 37 seconds. The morning when Job got up and went and offered his sacrifice, Job had no idea whatsoever what was going to take place in his life. He didn't know that he was going to lose his camels. He didn't know he was going to lose his donkeys. He didn't know he was going to lose his oxen. And he sure had no idea whatsoever that his 10 children, 7 sons and 3 daughters, would be killed that day. Job had no clue whatsoever. And as we are closing out this night tonight, and as we wake up to whatever it is we're going to face tomorrow, we have no clue what's going to be tomorrow. Tomorrow we could wake up, and as far as we know in life, we could pretty well lose it all. I am amazed at the amount of people that are in our world today. And I was just raised in a different place with different parents and different values from what a lot have. But I don't think my parents ever had a credit card in their entire life. You either carried cash or you wrote a check, and a credit card was taboo. You did not have a credit card. If we don't have money to pay for it, we're not going to get it. That's the way that I was raised. But you would be amazed the friends that I have that are my age and younger, and you go to a place and they say, well, our systems are down. We're not able to take a card right now. And they're stuck. I mean, they don't have $20 stuck back. They don't have $100 stuck back. They don't have anything. And if you got $5, you ain't gonna buy nothing but a piece of bubble gum. Hello? And you'll find that they're like that. But do you know in the morning we could get up and all these systems that controls all that card sliding stuff that we do could be down?
Yep.
And a lot of people would be stuck.
Amen.
I mean, if I was like a lot of people, I could be down here in Georgia tonight and say if I had not already filled up my truck and I was planning on filling it up out here at Walmart on my way back to Taylorsville and everything went down, I'd be stuck here. Well, I guess I could walk. And if mama calls, I'm going to walk. But if they close down everything else, they're probably going to close down and shut down the cell phones as well. But everything in your world could be turned upside down, and everything in your world could change just between now and the morning. But here you'll find that Job had to deal with the stress of losing all the financial things that he had in his life. He had to deal with the stress of losing his children in his life. And in this text, Job is having to deal with the stress of losing it all. Now listen to the question I'm about to ask you, and I'm going to ask you again in just a moment of time. When you have lost it all, what do you have left? When you have lost it all, what do you have left? You are the only person that can answer that for you. For some people, if they lose all their finances, that's everything. They don't have anything else to fall back on. For some people, if their family was taken away from them, they have lost everything. They don't have anything else to fall back on in this life. But the question that I present before you tonight is, if you have lost it all, what will you have left? Now, we have stress each and every day. We have lived. We've not seen it to the extent of what my parents saw it. But we have heard tell of the stock market crashes. We know about the Great Depression or recession of 2008, where life changed for a lot of people, where nobody had work and nobody had money and nobody had this and that and the other. We know about the stock market crashes. We know, hear tell about tragic deaths in accidents. I got up this morning and I always check the news in Taylorsville, and as I flipped on the news in Taylorsville, less than 3 miles from my house last night at 8 o'clock, a 20-something-year-old young man who had just bought his motorcycle this week against his mother's wishes was killed last night in a motorcycle wreck. You never know what's going to happen. The other Wednesday night, we were in church and we were about to dismiss, and one of my men that sat back on this side had gone out, and he came back in and he said, "Preacher, I just received a phone call, and I wanted to tell anybody that's going to be traveling towards Lenore going home, there's a bad wreck up there, the road is shut down, and they may want to go a different way." Did not know that it was the dad of one of the men that was in our church. A young man hit him head on. The young man, 17 years old, died instantaneously there on the spot. The man in his 60s lived through it, but he's got a lot of aches, he's got a lot of pains, and he's got a lot of problems. We never, never know how things are going to go. Homes are destroyed by storms. Property is stolen every day. High prices are coming more. Turn on the news and you'll get depressed if you're not only already depressed. There is all types of stress that are in our world. But it's one thing to hear about a wreck over here. It's one thing to hear about the stock market over here. It's another thing for somebody to get a health diagnosis over here. But I want you to understand, we can handle one thing happening here and there. But old Job, everything hit him at once. It wasn't just this. It wasn't just that. But all of this poured in on Job at one time. And Job was having to deal with the stress in his life of losing everything. Life can change in just a moment of time. But now in our text, what I've dealt with tonight, Job lost his financial possessions, and he also lost the pleasure of his family by his children being killed in this terrible storm that took place. Now, as you read further in the book of Job, you'll find that Job will eventually lose his health. He will have boils from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet and have to sit in sackcloth and ashes. You'll also find that Job will lose his position of authority where he once sat in the gate and was a man that everybody looked to. Now you're going to find Job sitting over here in a pile of ashes with everybody telling him, Job, you've done wrong, Job. You need to confess, Job. You need to get right with God, Job. And eventually he will even lose the sympathy of his wife when she will come to Job and say, Job, why don't you just curse God and die, get it over with. Just curse God and don't worry about it anymore. Job is a man that lost everything there was in life. But you'll notice the Bible tells us in verse number 22, in all of this, Job sinned not nor charged God foolishly. Job was a man that dealt with the stress of losing everything. But even though he lost everything, he still had the Lord in his life, and he did not sin against God, and he did not charge God foolishly. Real quickly tonight, and I've got to move real fast to get where I need to be. I want you to think first of all about Job's integrity. As you look at verse 1 through verse number 11, Job was a good man, and Job was a blessed man. Job was a man, the Bible describes as a perfect man, a man that feared God, and a man that eschewed evil. Now understand, when the Bible calls Job a perfect man, it's not saying that Job never did anything wrong. That's not what the Bible says. But Job was a man that was doing his best to live for God and serve God as best as a man humanly could live for and serve God. He has raised loving and compassionate children. What they were all doing together, they were celebrating one of their birthdays. And as they had all gathered together in one house to celebrate a birthday, it was because of the love and the compassion that they had for each other that had been instilled in them by their father Job. Somebody said, Preacher, I wonder why Job was not there with them. The reason I come up with is probably the same reason that I would have not been there. Anytime you're a dad and they have a get-together, the bill is always passed to dad. Oldest son has a birthday, dad'll pay for it. Middle son has a birthday, dad'll pay for it. Mama has a birthday, dad'll pay for it. I have a birthday, I still get to pay for it. Might be why Job decided to stay at home. I do not know, but I've often wondered about that. But nonetheless, they were all gathered together, having this meal together. And Job is over there praying for his children. Because you know what? He said it's a very real possibility with all of them gathered together that they could get upset and they could get angry about something and cause a problem in our family. A lot of people like to say, well, preacher, they was drinking wine. I think I can find the argument to tell you there. That's not referring to intoxicating wine of what they was drinking. I can give you that argument tonight because they were gathered together and they were enjoying each other's company. Whenever this passed by in their life. But I want you to understand, Job was a good man. Job was a man of integrity. Job was a man that everybody looked up to. And understand this, it was not just what people said about Job, but it was what God said about Job. Now, a lot of you I don't know that well, but I believe you're a good somebody. I believe you got a good reputation in the community that you live in here. But I really don't know who you are when you're alone and nobody else is around. But God said to Satan, "Hast thou considered my servant Job?" God knew what Job was when nobody else was around. God knew what Job did when nobody else was watching, and God still said he was a perfect man, an upright man, a man that feared God, and a man that eschewed evil. So I want you to understand, when this storm came in Job's life, and when this trial came in Job's life, Job had done nothing wrong. Nothing wrong. And here comes all this stress. God, I'm trying to live for you. I'm trying to serve you. And God, I'm trying to honor you. And Lord, I don't understand why this is happening in my life. Listen to what I'm about to say. When a man has formed excellence in his life, he will also form an enemy in his life. The book of Proverbs, chapter number 29 and verse number 27 says, "An unjust man is an abomination to the just, and he that is upright in the way is an abomination to the wicked." In other words, whenever somebody sells out to God and says, "God, I'm going to serve you lock, stock, and barrel," I want you to understand the devil puts his crosshairs on that man, and the devil starts working against that man, because the devil is against a man that'll pray. The devil is against a man that'll live right. The devil is against a man that'll sacrifice in the work and in the service of the Lord. Job was a man of integrity. But I want you to notice also, according to his integrity, Satan was his enemy. Now in verse number 7, I believe it is, of our text, the Bible says that all the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. You know, if it wasn't for this passage in Job, we wouldn't understand that all people are subject to give an account unto God. All bodies, celestial bodies, satanic bodies, human bodies, we're all accountable unto God. And I don't know if this meeting is held once a day, if it's held once a week, if it's held once a month, or once every 10,000 years. I do not know when this meeting is held, but there is a meeting held. And as they were all coming in verse number 7, the Lord looked at Satan. He said, "Satan, where you been?" And you learn some things about the devil there. You learn, number one, that his domain is the earth. He is the prince of the power of the air. He is the one that's running loose on this earth. You learn about his domain. But you also notice how he is a restless spirit. Because he is constantly going here. He is constantly going there. He is constantly watching for something, some opportunity in somebody's life where he can inject some sorrow, where he can stir up some trouble, where he can cause some problem in his life. So we learn some things from this text about Job and his integrity, and we learn some things about the enemy that Job has in Satan in this text as well. And you'll find that Satan doubted the integrity of Job's service. Now, preacher, what are you talking about there? By doubting the integrity of Job's service, I want you to understand that the devil doesn't believe Job or any other Christian is really real. He doubts the integrity of all of the children of God. And he wants to prove God wrong in every believer's life. Oh, that preacher claims he loves you, but you take his riches away, will he still love you? That Sunday school teacher claims that he loves you, but if you take her children away, would they still love you? The devil doubts the integrity of everyone that claims the name of Christ. But I want to tell you something. Job was real. I'm glad in my life that I have met a few people in this life that I really believe was real. I wasn't able to follow them home, but I'm thankful they started a walk with God. They stayed consistent in the walk with God. And when they checked out of this walk of life, they were still faithful unto God. Thank God there are some people that were real. Job was a man of integrity. The second thing I want you to notice tonight, not only was Job a man of integrity, but Job was also a man of innocency. Now, in my notes, I had this down as ignorance, but I think innocency works a lot better here. Because I want you to understand, there are some things that took place in this chapter in the life of Job that Job knew absolutely nothing about. And because Job knew nothing about, you'll find that God has used that to help us in the Christian walk of life. Now, Job is a consecrated man. Are you with me tonight? Job was a man that worked hard within the will of God. Job was a man that raised his family right and has been blessed abundantly by the Lord because of his faithfulness to God. And Job has done absolutely nothing to bring this trial and this test into his life. But you'll find that he was ignorant of some things that was going on. Innocent, if you will. He did not know, first of all, about the construction of his testimony. Job is flesh and blood just like you. Job get up in the morning and Job would spend time with God. Job get done spending time with God, Job would go eat his Cheerios or go fry him an egg or something like that. Job get done with that, Job would go outside. He'd check on his camels. He'd check on his oxes. He'd check on his donkeys. He'd check on his children. Job was a man that was just living life, taking it as he come, serving God and probably paying taxes, because that's something we all got to do. We all got to die and we all got to pay taxes. Job is just going through life doing this. He did not know that God was going to use his trial, and through the trial that he goes through in his life, God was going to help generations of people to come through what Job was going through. And he had no clue about this as to what God was doing in his life and what God was doing in his heart. Tonight, I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't know what it is that is causing you stress. For some people, if their spouse would die, they would feel like they had gone through the stress of losing everything. For other people, if they would lose their finances, the stock market would crash, our plastic would get cut off, and all of that would take place. They would feel like they had lost everything if that had taken place. Well, listen, whenever all this trial started happening in Job's life, whenever the donkeys and the camels were stolen, and whenever the oxen were carried away, and whenever he heard about this storm, Job did not know God was going to write a book about him. He didn't know that. Just a man living life. He had no clue whatsoever that God was constructing his testimony. And listen, whenever you are going through these trials in life, God is doing more than just you living life. God is constructing a testimony in your life through the trials that you go through the troubles that you go through the problems that you go through in your life. Because somewhere down the road, you're going to run into somebody else that they're going to go through the same trouble. They're going to go through the same trial. They're going to go through the same heartache. And you can always say, let me tell you what happened to me when I felt like I had lost it all and that there was nothing else that I could do. Listen, God was constructing his testimony. And Job didn't even know God was constructing his testimony. Now, one thing else we learn about God there, and I'm going to move on. God said you can come this far, but you can't come no farther. Boy, I wonder how many things God has kept back from us. I wonder how much worse this life could be if God hadn't said, hold on, don't you touch him anymore. Don't you go any further with him. Right here's the line. You can't go. You can't step over that. You stop right there. And the devil had to respect whatever it was God said. But listen to me, listen to me, listen to me. Anytime God gives a devil permission, there's always a purpose. Romans 8:28, still in the Bible.
Amen.
All things work together for good to them that love the Lord. God is always working. Whenever we're a man like Job and we're doing our best to serve God, and all of a sudden this has hit us, and all of a sudden that's hit us, and all of a sudden something else has hit us, and we're there in stress and anxiety and don't understand why all this is happening in our life, God is constructing something in our testimony to use to bring glory to his name. He knew nothing about the construction of his testimony. He knew nothing about the conversation about his trial. If it wasn't for the book of Job, we wouldn't know about this time when the sons of God come to present themselves to the Lord. Oh, we know about the great white throne judgment. We know about the judgment seat of Christ. We wouldn't know about this little gathering that they have when the sons of God, the angels, come and present themselves to the Lord, and that the devil shows up at this. As you know, at one time, the devil was an angel. Hello? Now, let me ask you a question. Reckon if they met this morning, Brother Doug, if they talked about us. Reckon if they met this morning, we were the subject of their conversation. Some of you that's had the worst month, this was a year of Job's life. Some of you that's had the worst year of your life, could be a year ago, there's a little conversation. And the Lord said, have you considered my servant down there in Toccoa, Georgia? Stevens County, Habersham, whatever county, Tugaloo. Hello? Have you considered my servant down there? You say, preacher, I've had the worst year of my life. Might be God brought you up as the subject and said, have you considered my servant, Stacy? Have you considered my servant, Titus? Have you considered my servant, Kaylee? Have you considered my servant, Luther? And all this stuff has started coming in because there is something that God is wanting to work. And Job don't know all this, Brother Doug. But Job is feeling the stress of this. Job knows what has happened. But Job doesn't know why it has happened. Job's just living life. He wasn't planning on somebody writing a book about all his troubles. He wasn't planning on the problems of his life being laid out for all eternity to view and see how Job did in those trials. I've got to hurry on. We see Job's integrity. We see Job's innocency. But we also see, and don't worry, I've got 4 points tonight, but I promise I'm going to hurry up because I'm ready to go to Taylorsville. Hello. Mama's calling. Hallelujah. Amen. But notice also Job's injury. As you begin to read in our text in verse number 12, that's where Job's storm is about to begin. And Job has an injury there. And understand, the devil has not attacked him physically yet. But the injury that Job suffers is an emotional injury. It's a psychological injury. It is a spiritual injury that Job has to deal with in his life. Because God gave the devil permission, but he can go no further than what God permits. And as I said, when God gives permission, there's always a purpose behind it. But real quickly, notice in verse number 12, there's no waste of time. As soon as the Lord gives permission to the devil to attack Job, notice what it says in verse number 12. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord just as soon as he got opportunity. He wasted no time whatsoever. I'm going to get out there. I'm going to attack Job. God, I'm going to prove you wrong. I'm going to show you this man Job is not near what you think that he is. He wasted no time. But notice also, it was not weighted by transgression. Now hear what I'm about to say. It wasn't Job's sin, but it was Job's righteousness that caused this trial to come in his life. And listen, the main reason that Job had to suffer the way that Job had to suffer was because God Almighty wanted to silence Satan and God Almighty wanted to prove Satan wrong. Could it be the trial that you're facing, the stress that I'm dealing with in my life, could be God just wants to use my life to say, shut up, Slewfoot. You're wrong again, because my servant has proven that my grace is all sufficient. There was no waste of time. It was not weighted by transgression. But notice also, he nauseously wiped out all the treasures. I want you to understand, Satan's totally wiped him out. And by what took place in Job's life in verse number 20, it literally made Job sick. He rent his clothes. He shaved his head. He put on sackcloth as a result of what had taken place in his life. It literally made Job sick by what was going on. Now listen, Job had once had a big house. Job once had a lot of income and a lot of possessions in his life. But that's not what Job needed to be able to stand against God. Now if God is blessing you, praise God. But don't get so intoxicated in having things in this life. Because whenever you're dealing with stress, it doesn't matter how big your house is. Whenever you're dealing with stress, it don't matter how new your vehicle is. Whenever you're dealing with stress, it doesn't matter all these accolades. You better have God in your life, and you better have a relationship with God in your life. Now let me just sort of tell you real quick, and I'm going to move on to the last point real quickly. You'll find the first thing, the Sabians came and stole his livestock and killed his servants. 500 donkeys and 500 yoke of oxen. I don't know what the nearest big tractor place is around here up where I live at. It's called James River Equipment, and they sell John Deere's. I want you to know when 500 yoke of oxen were killed, that is the equivalent of 1,000. A yoke, that's two. So a yoke of oxen, he had 1,000 oxen died. There were 500 yoke of oxen. That would be the equivalent of you going down here to the local tractor dealership and you ordering 500 brand spanking new tractors, those that they bring out to you with wide load on the front of the vehicle that they're following behind, and them be put in your yard. Listen, if you have bought one tractor lately, hello, that's an expensive thing. But can you imagine losing 500 of them? He also lost 700 sheep. That would refer to two things. It would refer to the clothing industry, and it would also refer to the food industry. So not only has he lost 500 brand new John Deere tractors, he has also had a business that he was transacting in the clothing industry that was wiped out. A food industry job that he had, a chain of restaurants, they were wiped out. Then you'll find he came in. The Chaldeans stole the camels, and the camels were the truck of the desert. So it would be the equivalent there of him losing 3,000 camels. 3,000 transfer trucks. I'm going to tell you, Job lost a lot. Not to mention all his servants. Not to mention his 10 children that a tornado destroyed. And you'll find that, now I want you to notice this. All these animals and all these servants, but God left 4 servants. Or the devil left these 4 servants. And the reason the devil left these 4 servants, because these were 4 negative Nellies. Hello? Because all they did, Doug, is they come and brought bad news. And he left his wife, too, because she was mad and aggravated at him as well. Now, I say this, and I'm going to move on real quickly. Listen, I wonder if the devil would leave you. Because he knew that you'd be more of a hindrance to him alive than you would be dead. Boy, I could jump on a bunch of stuff there, but we're on Facebook Live, and I want to be able to walk back in somewhere in Taylorsville whenever I go back home. Hello? But I wonder if the devil would leave you. But in all this has happened, all this has happened. Job is under all this stress. He has lost the clothing industry. He has lost the chain of restaurant. He has lost the transfer truck. He has lost the tractors that he had. But even more than that, he's lost the 10 children of his life.
Right.
His integrity. His indecency. His injury. But the last thing I want you to see is Job's importance. What was it in Job's life that kept Job from sinning? And what was it in Job's life that kept him from charging God foolishly? So we see people with stress every day. A lot of people cuss a blue streak when they get stressed. I had a fella today that I played golf with that wasn't playing too well. And then I wasn't playing too well either. And he said, "Now, preacher, we just come to have a good time." He kept telling me that over and over. "Preacher, we just have a good time. We're not going to throw knives, and we're not going to do this, that, or the other." And we did not cuss. We wrote a few down and signed them, but we did not cuss. No, we didn't write none. A lot of people in stress, they cuss. A lot of people in stress, they get mad at somebody else and start blaming them when they ain't got a thing in the world to do with it. A lot of people, when the stress comes in their business and being stole, they want to sue somebody. And I mean, they're looking for somebody to blame. But what was it in Job's life where it says of Job that in all this he sinned not, nor he charged God foolishly? Real quickly, in verse number 5, I want you to notice there was some preventive maintenance that went on. Old Job, every morning whenever he got up, the Bible tells us that he would go out there and he would offer up this sacrifice for his children. And he would offer up praying on their behalf, not knowing what might have been done. Listen, I've got a duty and I've got an obligation. I can't lay in the bed till 10 o'clock in the morning because I've got a daughter that goes to work at 6 o'clock in the morning. I've got another daughter that goes to work about 7 o'clock in the morning. I got another daughter that goes to work about 8:30 in the morning. I got a wife that goes to work 3 days a week at 8:30 in the morning. And listen, I got to get out there somewhere and I've got to offer up on their behalf some prayers towards heaven, because I don't know what's out ahead in their life. I don't know what they're going to face. I told you last year about my youngest daughter going to work one morning, and Mom and I were at home. I believe it was on a Monday or a Tuesday morning, and the phone rang and Lisa come running through the house. She said, "Neal, we got to go, and we got to go now. Maddie has had a wreck." And I remember as I rounded the curve and I drove up on that scene, and I saw where her car had flipped down the bank about three times, and I saw her standing on the side of the road, tears running down her face. Oh, but the only thing she had was a little scratch on her knee where she climbed over the glass to get out on the passenger side. Oh, I'm glad that morning I went before the throne of God and I prayed for my youngins for God to watch after them. And listen, stress is going to come. The bottom is going to fall out. There's going to be troubles and trials in our life. Oh, but thanks be unto God. Whenever we're praying every morning, we're doing some preventive maintenance. Whenever we're coming to revival every night, we're doing some preventive maintenance. Whenever we're reading that Bible every day, thank God we're doing some preventive maintenance to help us when the storm comes in life. I've used the illustration before. 12 years ago, Lisa and I, we've been in our house for 12 years. So 13 years ago, we started building our house. And I think I've told you this before. I did as much on my house as I could. I laid the brick, I laid the rock, I helped pour the concrete, I helped the carpenters, I handed them wood, I pushed up plywood. I did anything I could. One day the contractor, he come in and he said, "Preacher, you want something to do?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Here, go nail these things onto the rafters in the wall." I said, "What is them things?" He said, "Hurricane straps." I said, "Hurricane straps?" He said, "Yeah, there wasn't a cloud in the sky." Hello? It was hot. It was pleasant, but it was hot. There wasn't no storm going on. I got out there, I nailed one to the rafter. Nail one to the wall. Nail one to the rafter. Nail one to the wall. Nail one to the rafter. Nail one to the wall. Didn't a storm come up that day. But here a couple years ago, we had a series of tornadoes that swept through our community. And I mean, there's trees down. There's people's roof, part of it got blowed off, this, that, and the other. One limb on my 22 acres that I found it was down. That's all that I found. You know what? Them old hurricane straps done pretty good. Amen.
Amen.
It wasn't a storm whenever it was coming. But we got things ready and prepared for a later time when a storm would come. And I want you to understand them mornings when Job, he was tired. Whenever Job didn't feel like getting up, he still got up because he knew his sons and his daughters would be gathering together. And he did that preventive maintenance of lifting things up to God. Listen, you want to be able to stand for God when the stress of losing it all comes to your life? Be faithful in that preventive maintenance. Listen, I know there's a bunch of people should be here that's not been here. Probably they don't like the preacher that you have. That might be why they didn't come. And for whatever reason, they're not here. Listen, there's going to be stress in their life. There's going to be storms in their life. And they're not going to be ready. Oh, but thanks be unto God for those little ones that are there every time the doors are open, saying, "God, give me a little bit more. God, load me a little bit more." Because God knows what I'm going to need in my life.
Amen.
He did some preventive maintenance. Second thing you'll find, Job practiced some manners. Preacher, what are you talking about practicing manners? How many years do you coach? 25 years of coaching. I didn't coach near that long. I got my titles quick and I retired early. Okay. One thing I've learned about kids: the way they practice is the way they'll play. If they're good at practice, they'll be good in a game situation. If they're sorry in practice, most of the time they'll be sorry in the game. Job was a perfect man, upright man, feared God, and eschewed evil in the good times. Then when the bad times come around, Job was a perfect man, Job was a good man. Job was a God-fearing man. Job was a man that eschewed evil. Why? Because he had practiced good manners in the good times, and he practiced good manners in the bad times. Listen, if whenever you get angry, you don't want to cuss a blue streak, don't cuss a blue streak whenever you're not angry. Hello? That's the best way to take care of that and best way to do that. Had a preacher friend told me one time, his daddy was a preacher as well, and he said he wasn't a preacher then. He said, I was outside the will of God. I knew I was outside the will of God, and he said, I was helping my daddy birth a calf one day. He said, all of a sudden, I was back there pulling that calf out, and all of a sudden, that calf come out at one time, and he said, that calf rolled all the way up me. He said, I had calf all over me. And he said, after I got done, he said, man, I let a word fly. And he said, I hoped my daddy didn't hear it. He said, we went on and finished what we did. He said, I was still trying to get that stuff off of me. He said, all my daddy said was this. If you don't want to have that language come out of you when you're around me, don't use that language when you're away from me. Amen. Job practiced good manners in his life. He had them in the manner of woe. Listen, in verse number 20, whenever Job, he rent his clothes, he put on sackcloth, he sat in ashes. That is the normal way of mourning. In the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4, verse number 13, Bible talks about that we sorrow not, even as those which have no hope. Listen, whenever somebody dies, you ought to be sad. Whenever somebody dies, it ought to bother you. You ought to have some sorrow in your life, but it should not overwhelm you to the point. You can't walk, you can't talk, you can't function. We're to sorrow not as others which have no hope. There is a degree of sorrow, but it's not supposed to be an overshow of emotions, an overshow of this. Why? Because we walk with God, and God has given us grace in the good time, and God is going to give us grace in the bad time. Job knew how to behave himself whenever he had the manner of woe. But notice also the mention of worship there. To worship at this time in Job's life, I want you to understand, it showed his approval of what God had done, and it showed his acceptance of what God had done. He didn't know why God did what he did, but he knew that God had never made a mistake. And because God had never made a mistake, old Job said, God, I'm still going to trust you. I'm still going to believe you. I'm still going to lean on you. He wasn't looking for somebody to blame. He wasn't looking for somebody to sue. Even though he didn't know why, he just trusted God with what was going on in his life and in his heart. Listen, are you at peace today with what's going on in your life where you can worship God? I preached this Sunday at our church, and as I was preaching it, I told him my dad has been gone for 19 years. If I would have known that Wednesday night when I left Baptist Hospital and traveled home, if I would have known, Brother Doug, that was going to be his last day on earth, I'd have never left. I'd have called somebody else and said, you handle prayer meeting tonight. I need to be down here with my daddy. He's fixing to go to the other side. I didn't know that he was going to pass away that February night. Daddy had some problems with his heart, and they were needing to do a catheterization, a dye test to check his heart. But because he was having some other complication, he couldn't lay still on the table long enough for them to do that. The doctor even made the statement. He said, now, before we'll let anything happen to your daddy, we'll give him a dose of this or we'll do this, and because of that, he'll be okay and he'll be able to have this and get it done. Well, they didn't do it, and he died of a heart attack in the hospital. I was a little upset, but then God reminded me that my daddy is not going to die a second sooner than what he's supposed to die. That he was going to die at the time. It's no use getting mad at the doctor. Ain't no use cussing out the doctor. There ain't no sense in suing the hospital. When God says it's your time to go, you're going. Now, I know you can do stupid stuff to hasten that time. But when it's their time, they're going to go. But I remember when my family assembled in the vestibule area of Poplar Springs Baptist Church. And I've told other families, the hardest time for me, now I've done I don't know how many funerals, but the hardest time I've ever had was when we were fixing to step in the back door of my daddy's funeral. Preacher, I thought I was going to hyperventilate. I mean, I've done hundreds of funerals. I've been to hundreds of funerals. I've sang at them. I've preached at them. I've been pallbearer at them. I've been to all these different funerals. But honestly, it's just like a devil had a hold of me right there. And I thought I was going to hyperventilate. I mean, my mama always said, take three deep breaths. You know, and it wasn't working. We stepped in the back door and Then came grace. And I was able to lift my hands and worship the Lord at my daddy's funeral. It matters how you live your life in the good times if you want to live your life to please God in the bad times. We see the preventive maintenance. We see the practice of his manners. I'm almost done. We see also the providential mindfulness. Everything Job, verse number 21, everything Job had in his life had been given to him by God. It was his to take it whenever he wanted to take it. One writer said this, keep a loose hold on the things of this world. Because what have you got left when you lose it all? I'm sitting in a blessed congregation tonight. You've got health. You've got strength. I can look at you and tell there ain't too many of you missed a meal. Hello? We're a blessed people. But if God's, I mean, why am I not down here on the street? We'll work for food. Why am I not sitting over there at the hospital, the abandoned hospital in Taylorsville, going, why am I not there? Why did God let me be born in a Christian home instead of being born to some meth addict, some crackhead somewhere? Why did God let me enjoy what I've enjoyed? And I thank him for everything that I've enjoyed. But if he'd take it all away, he'd still be God. But what would I have left if I lose it all? Last thing, there was praise to the master. What happened? Job honored God. He proved Satan wrong. And he gave glory to God by the way Job conducted himself when he had to deal with the stress of losing it all. Tonight, it might be somebody needs to come down here and do some preventive maintenance. Lord, everything's good in my life tonight. But God, you've nudged my heart, and God, I don't know why. Lord, I thank you for all those blessings. I thank you for them grandbabies. Lord, I thank you, dear God, for that good wife.
Lord, I thank you for that vehicle you've blessed me to drive. Lord, I thank you for that house you've let me live in. God, I just want to do a little preventive maintenance tonight in case you'd take it all away. I still want to honor you with my life. Maybe tonight some of you need to say, God, I want you to help me in my practice during the good times so that I can honor you in the grieving times. Maybe tonight you need to come down and just say, Lord, I don't know why, but I don't want to lose it because I'm an ingrate. God, I just want to thank you for what you've done in my life. Don't know how God may be dealing with you. And I hope this doesn't happen. If somebody feels like they've lost it all. But if you do, what have you got left? We're standing tonight. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Whoever Brother Doug has lined up to sing tonight wants you to be coming and getting ready. I appreciate how these are already quickly moving to the altar. God knows the needs of their life and the needs of their heart. I apologize tonight for preaching longer than what I normally would preach. But it took me 2 services to preach this at the church, and I just want to be sensitive unto the Lord. You mind what God would have you do tonight? What have you got left if you lose it all? The stress of losing it all. Glad God can help us tonight, wherever we're at, whatever we're dealing with, whatever we have need of, God's able. Would you mind him tonight as he speaks to your heart? When y'all get ready, y'all go right ahead. Amen.
That's my God.